The first series of Ted Lasso is not just a show I think is good. I mean, I do think it's good, but it's more than that. It's an Apple TV Plus justifier in a world of rip-off and unnecessary streaming services. It's a show made with love, passion, genuine heart. It's a show that made me realize I actually could like football, something I never thought I could say about myself. It's got its problems, certainly, but generally, let me tell you, this show is damn good. I actually wrote most of this script before the entirety of season 2 came out, so it's been updated a little bit, but there won't be any spoilers in this video, don't worry. So here's the basic layout for the video. I'm going to analyze the first episode pretty much completely and leave the rest of the show unspoiled for you. There'll be some things that I praise through how they lead to character development, which might make your brain guess at pseudo-spoilers, but I'll keep it as vague as general as possible for you. After that, I'm going to let you in on a little secret about this video. Then sum up my opinions, thank you for watching, end card, boom, job done. Let's get cracking, shall we? Ted Lasso was a character from NBC Sports, made to comedically promote the Premier League in America. How do we get Americans interested in Premier League football? Well, Jason Sudeikis opted for an eccentric American football coach, claiming to be the newest manager of Tottenham Hotspur. Some of the jokes they make in these little promo videos even made it into the final series.
I know that AFC Richmond, like any team I've ever coached, is going to go out there and give you everything they got for all four quarters.
Halves.
What was that?
Two halves.
Oh, right, sorry. Halves, yeah. They're going to give you everything they got for two halves, win or lose.
Or tie.
Right, y'all do ties here.
However, it wasn't until 2017 when Bill Lawrence was approached to develop a TV series for the character. Bill Lawrence has earned his stripes when it comes to creating and writing TV shows. The man made Scrubs, for Christ's sake. I have no experience with his other projects, but Scrubs was, at least for a few seasons, truly great. But Ted Lasso isn't only great when compared to Scrubs. For my money, it wholly surpasses it. Or at least, the first season of Ted Lasso is better than any season of Scrubs. Or really, any series I can think of. This feels like a story the people involved have been dying to tell, and now they can do it through a comedic premise and completely fresh expectations. They didn't have to go as hard as they did, but they did. They did that for us and for themselves, and it really shines through. To steal a footballing analogy, Lawrence and his team were on excellent form when writing this show. Also, hey, turns out Zach Braff actually directed one of the episodes. Go figure. So, the first episode then. It starts with basically all the information we need to know. The boss is no-nonsense, the coach is an asshole. She's also running the place now as her own club.
Whatever it is you need to get off your impressive chest,
let me have it.
Of course. You're fired.
We get to see how these two characters bounce off each other. Ted's great, just going with the flow, seeing what happens. Beard's the one doing all the research, learning the sport, the secret genius. We understand why Ted doesn't seem deterred by the big change. We see how close they are with this comment about fooling around with their dreams.
If we see each other in our dreams, let's goof around a little bit, pretend like we don't know each other.
You got it, stranger.
Nice.
It's just the perfect way to establish these characters and their bond. Basically, every character's main introduction is perfect for who they are, which is all a pilot episode really needs to do. Set up the main and supporting cast in an enticing way, and hint at the overall plot, which will leave you wanting more later. The other thing a pilot needs to do, which I think is kind of underrated, is sell you on the opening credits. This is going to greet you every episode, so ideally you want that skip intro button to be used as little as possible. Even the intro to this show is filled with symbolism and meaning, while keeping an original aesthetic and sounding great. I bought this song on iTunes, no joke, I'd love this song. It's not an incredible intro, but the fact that they use it to say so much, man, it feels like everyone involved in this series is giving their absolute best for this show. The first time he meets Ollie, Ted asks his name and insists they carry their own bags. It's a small touch, but I love it. This isn't even the last time we see this character. The writers have a reason for such a minor piece of character development. Everything feels so essential, intentional. There's not a beat out of place when you watch this show. The show does this a lot, actually. Drops hints towards character expressions and dialogues, which lead to bigger reveals. We get to the club and meet Nate, who tries to shoo them off the grass. I said grass. His pronunciation's got me now. Ah, my granddad would be proud. However, he immediately recedes when he realizes he's talking to someone in a position of power. Nate, in these few lines of dialogue, is determined and clearly a hard worker, but also too shy and introverted for his own good. The MVP of this show, however, is Hannah Waddingham, playing Rebecca Welton.
MVP!
MVP! MVP!
Her character is complex, her naturally imposing height and strong, forthright figure lends itself so well to this character, and she really seems like she's relishing the chance to do so much with Rebecca Welton. Hannah could have easily played her as just a shallow, empty villain, but the writing and especially the performance elevates this character to being probably the best in the series, if not one of.
Oh, do you believe in ghosts, Ted?
I do. But more importantly, I think they need to believe in themselves. Yeah.
The joke about ghosts needing to believe in themselves is perfect, as is Rebecca's dismissive response. Ted Lasso is one of the only comedy shows I can think of where, with every joke, we at least learn something about the character, the world, or the supporting cast. Every joke has a purpose. It's so refreshing to be laughing at comedy and be engaged in a story when so many comedies limit themselves to one or the other. It also helps that the actual jokes are, for the most part, well written. All the dialogue in this show is pretty masterclass, actually. And I think it feels like there are so many great moments per episode because the episodes are short. There's no time to add needless filler to detract from the crucial scenes like so many other series with hour-long episodes and 20 episodes a season and shit like that. The 30-minute episode length really shows just how great a series can be when it strips away needless, pointless indulgences. The press scene is needed to emphasize just how out of his element Ted is, just how much the media and everyone else underestimates him. There's some great foreshadowing, and the lads in the pub reflect the average viewer and how some might actually like him. It also sums up Trent Crim as being the personification of the skeptical media. For the rest of the series, we now know that Trent Crim will serve as a barometer for the general public's perception and the journalist's perspectives. Right now, he's here to show that even Ted Lasso, with his upbeat attitude, isn't invulnerable.
You got a question in there, Trent?
Yeah. Is this a fucking joke?
Thank you, Trent!
I love journalists.
The scenes where they first watch the training, I'm going to break down into two sections. Firstly, the scene shows us more of the neurotic but kind of endearing nature of Nate. He automatically assumes Ted's going to insult his drink, and he's surprised when Ted remembers his name, so he's used to being overlooked and ridiculed. Even his assessment of Jamie shows us that Nate never looks to badmouth someone.
Nate, what's he like?
Well, Jamie?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's great.
You know, football.
Is this through fear of repercussions or a genuine good heart? That all comes down to how you interpret it. But it's nice development disguised as a joke. Secondly, we learn a lot about the players, mostly because Ted learns a lot about the players. Ted doesn't know a lot of these things and needs to be told. And this also plays into the dynamic he has with Coach Beard I mentioned earlier. Coach knows. Coach knows everything.
I mean, he must be from England, yeah?
Wales.
Is that another country?
Yes and no.
I love the office scene. The two sit down and with no words, they both know exactly what to do. We remember just how close and in sync they are despite having different approaches and mindsets. Even little things like what specifically they use to decorate their part of the office aren't skimped on. It establishes Beard as his own character, separate to just being Ted, but smart and quiet. You know what other bit I love? This line.
He thinks he's mad now. Wait till we win him over.
He'll be furious.
It sums up their motives and why they keep trying with people, and it's the perfect line to understand Ted Lasso as a character. It basically sums up everything you need to know about the character in one sentence. After that, Ted does some work on the locker room and shares a brilliant scene with Keeley. Keeley pranks him, but is immediately worried for his well-being. A joker with a good heart. Ted tries to make the room more inspiring with a Believe poster. He wants the club to see their potential like he can. He tapes over the naked ladies in Jamie's locker. Boom! A funny joke, which also informs the character, and Keeley appreciates this with a smile when she sees it, so we know more about her character too. She helps him straighten out the poster. Nice one, they're bonding. They're sharing a kind of mutual respect for each other. It's even more crooked when it's done. Fantastic. Ted was just happy to get Keeley involved. How crooked the sign was never really mattered to him. He then gets ready to move into his new place using Nathan's car and...
As the man once said, the harder you work, the luckier you get, huh?
I love that line. I'm repeating myself. Higgins having second thoughts. Great, we immediately know that Ted actually has a chance of winning at least some important people over. We then see Ted making jokes they're annoyed by, and we're reminded why this is going to be so hard for him. They're such different people, after all. Rebecca's final line before driving off.
There'll be elements to this little adventure that will weigh on you a bit, but I'm sure it won't be harder than it was to sneak all Rupert's women in and out behind my back all those years.
We learn everything about their relationship, and that Higgins is partly going along with this plan through guilt, and that he was too spineless to not be involved in her ex-husband's cheating, and that he's still too spineless to not be involved in running a Premier League football club into the ground while humiliating a nice guy in front of the entire country. One line with it carries so much nuance. Sure, a lot of this nuance is me reading a lot into lines, but the fact that I'm able to read so much into these lines is amazing. It's something I haven't really experienced with a lot of shows before. Ted and Coach go into their homes provided by the club and they get ready to turn in. The welcome basket with the wrong name, what a nice little piece of set design that shows how little Rebecca actually thinks of Ted. It's a brilliant little touch. They don't even really dwell on it. It's just there for you to notice if you're paying attention. The show really respects your intelligence in that way. The final scene we see in the first episode is half of a phone call. And wow, there's actually a lot of complex character building during it. Like, it finally clarifies exactly why he would fly to London for this job. It also shows his own personal struggles, which he hasn't said to anybody yet. Plus, the fact that we only have one side of this conversation? Huh. When Ted says, you don't have to, is he saying she doesn't have to apologize? Say she loves him back? We don't know for certain. It's great. It adds a nice personal touch for the viewer because they can read what they interpret into it. It's the perfect scene to end a pilot on because it shows us even Ted Lasso has something about himself that we still need to learn.
Shoot. Now I can't sleep.
And with that, the first episode is analyzed. And if any of my praise has made you even slightly interested in the series, claim your free trial of Apple TV Plus and give it a go. I actually have extensive notes about my favorite scenes from each individual episode. I'm that into this show. So if you guys cared to see that, please do let me know. But hopefully I sold you on at least checking out the show. If you reach episode 4 and you're not into it, then fair enough, you tried, and I'm sorry to recommend something that you didn't enjoy. I'll drop a little heads up here, though, that season 2 is definitely the Empire Strikes Back of seasons. By which I mean it's the darker second installment, and technically the fifth, but which sets up a lot for the next installment to come. Some characters go to some serious places, which might make you question what you think you know about them. Anna Waddingham described it as a rebirth, and I think that pretty much sums it up. I mention this partly as a warning as to what to expect, and partly to reinforce the idea of underestimating things to conclude. Oh, before I conclude, that little secret about this video? It was all recorded and edited from an iPad. I figured it was fitting, what with Apple TV Plus being the only way to watch this show. I'm curious though, could you tell this was done on an iPad? What did you think? Anyway, back to the thing. This whole series to me has been about challenging expectations. A silly comedy show about an American football coach managing Premier League soccer was all I expected from Ted Lasso. A decent exclusive to Apple TV Plus, as opposed to the flagship series for it, in my opinion. Thinking the writers wouldn't respect the viewers so much as to provide us heartwarming, challenging, and emotional moments to really reflect on. And yet, the show, much like Ted himself, has its own way of surpassing expectations. For that, I can really only thank the people who made this show. It helped me during a dark part of my life, and I'm really thankful for that. And I'm also really thankful to you for watching this video. If you liked it, then please do me a favor, leave me a little like, maybe a comment. If you really like the stuff I'm doing on this channel and you want to throw some pennies my way, as you may have noticed, I'm a little too small of a channel right now to actually get monetization on my videos. I have a Ko-fi account which you can donate to, but that's completely optional and up to you. There's certainly no pressure there. I wouldn't be making money off of half these videos anyway with these content ID vultures, so don't sweat it. I hope you enjoyed the video, and let me know what you're interested to see me talk about next. See you later, guys.